to a point where I had to be taken to a safe house. And I realized for about 10 years of my life, I've been fighting this thing, and I'm not willing to take myself back to that black hole again. I would rather focus on the positive things that I'm currently doing that will actually change lives. Putting myself on the spectrum or on the podium and say, well, so-and-so did this to me, at the end of the day, it's going to damage my mental health, you know, more than anything else. I mean, running a court case, getting investigations done to get DNA and all of this. There's been so many, even now, you know. So I would rather focus on the positive aspects of my life currently than do that. But however, I'll not also keep quiet about the dangers of getting raped. You know, the feeling of getting raped,
right.
The vulnerability, what it takes away, and how do we help people who are currently getting raped, you know?
Right.
So I would rather focus on that than just name drop.
Yeah.
Name dropping does not help in this country.
It doesn't help to get to the perpetrator and have them.
When you're in my situation,
okay.
When you're, for a person who, it's something that has just happened, they've got the full evidence, there's a process.
Right.
For me, it's been 10 years. It's a long process to get that correct information and to get DNA or footage or anything like that.
Right.
And fighting a political party in the country is difficult. And it's life-threatening.
You mentioned that you feel it's your responsibility to have these conversations.
Correct.
And to help girls so that they're better informed when making decisions.
Yes.
Like, listen, this could be detrimental to your life.
Yeah.
Do you feel that the authorities, in this case the police, have failed you?
Oh, of course.
Because they could have been assisting you in this
of
mission of protecting women or talking about these conversations, but do you feel they failed
you?
They
failed me so many times, Dumelo. I mean, even when after my rape, I tried to report it 4 times. And at some point, I was interrogated for actually trying to lay a charge against this person. And they said, well, do you know who this person is? Do you know what influence they have? Do you know that you could be dead in 24 hours if this were to go through? And funny enough, the police people who were interrogating me, amongst them were women. And for about 4, 5, 6 hours, I was in a cell or sort of a confined space where they interrogated me. I was a child, you know, getting interrogated by 6, 7 police officers. And even after that, just trying to get psychological help, trying to get family on board to help me, even they failed me, you understand? So it was bigger than just the rape.
Right.
It was just all the other people who were just continuously failing me. And that's why I took it upon myself to say, if I cannot help somebody who's in this situation, because I know exactly what a rape victim feels like at that particular point and what they need, you know. For instance, a doctor said to me the other day, I asked a girl, she said to the rape victim,
yeah,
you're going to be okay. And I said, no, you lied to that victim, because you can't say to a person who's just been raped, you're going to be okay.
Mm-hmm.
You need to say, we're going to find solutions so that you're okay.
And we will assist you.
We will assist you. What
is the feedback that you receive from young women when you spark up the conversations within Bear the Book, when you talk about your life experiences? Because I listened to a particular radio interview, and I remember listening and watching the feedback on social media. There seems to be a resistant in a sense that some are defensive to say, no, Jackie, it's not transactional sex. It's actually, we are influencers.
No, can we call a thing a
that's
thing?
What I want to know. Is there resistance in the message that you're sending, or are young women actually receiving it and coming out and saying, actually, I can relate to what you're talking about?
You know, the people that are coming out are the people who are getting burned. The ones who are in pain right now. The ones who are living the life and enjoying it, they are defensive. They don't want to talk about it. They want to give it different names. Influencer, I'm a working girl, I'm a hustler, I'm this, I'm a slay queen, whatever the case may be. You know, they want to give it beautiful names. But the point is, it's transactional. And transactional equates prostitution.
Mm.
You understand?
Mm-hmm.
So it does not matter in what paint we painted or what color we painted, but there's a transactional activity happening here.
Yeah.
And we must find ways to help them, because at the end of the day, you could be happy today because you got a handbag.
Yeah.
But what is he doing to you that's hurting you, that's damaging your soul, your mind, your integrity,
right.
That we cannot get back in 6 months, in a year's time?
Mm.
You know, what are the sexual transmitted diseases that he's giving you that you're not even aware of sometimes, because you're just thinking, oh, well, It's a quickie. I'm right. getting this. I'm sleeping with you once. I'm going to be okay.
Right.
You know, you get instances where girls are forced to sleep with multiple people because this one particular person who's financing is forcing the situation, especially when they're overseas.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they travel to Dubai, London, wherever. When they get to those countries,
right.
number one, they can't come back. Number two, they're forced to take drugs because they're there. What do you do? You're influenced.
Mm.
There's a pressure of being in that environment.
Right.
Number three, you get that even if you consent sex with one individual, because their friends and associates are there,
right.
you're not consenting for
do
everybody.
Do you have the conversations with the men? Because the conversations are with the women. And in this instance, they feel like, I feel like it comes across as if they're the victim, they are pressurized,
no.
They're put under pressure. But what is the conversation with the blesser in this instance? What are they saying with regards to this conversation?
Blessers, this is the power struggle. You know, blessers are okay with it. As a matter of fact, they want to boast how much they have. They want to compete amongst themselves. They want to show the girls that we can afford you. You know, we can buy you. They're not in a position of, hey, we're hurting these girls. We're exploiting them. We are infecting them in some instances. You know, some of these slave queens are 19, 18, 20. You know, that child is still growing mentally. They don't have the maturity or understanding of what they're doing.
Right.
You know, so the men are just using their power and their money to exploit them. And they are okay with it. They will not even reprimand each other.
Mm.
As a matter of fact, they will compete more.
All right. Okay. Jackie, we're about to let you go. But before we go, for anyone who hasn't read your book, what can they find?
Ooh, a lot of strength, a lot of heartbreak, a lot of raw and explicit information, but most importantly, the core finding yourself, who you are in the midst of everything, you know. I speak about family values in the very beginning, you know, first five chapters about family, the foundation a family bears on a child, and also the choices that people make. I made my decision, and luckily I could get out, and luckily I had the education behind me to back me up.
Right.
You know, I'm still studying as we speak. So we make choices, and I made mine. And at this point, it's okay. I'll be the sacrificial lamb for those who need me.
Jenny, thank you for your time.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. Of course, that's all the time we have for you today. We hope that.